ever had before in this place, God. Move by your power, God. Move by your spirit, God. You promised, you told us you take no pleasure in the flesh, God. So we bring down flesh right now in the name of Jesus. We cast down every imagination, hallelujah, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of you, God. We bring into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. We pray that you have your way, God, from the pulpit to the door, God. We pray that you have your way from the youngest to the oldest, God. Every living, breathing thing in this place, God, will give your name worship, God. We will give your name praise, hallelujah. We will give your name honor, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Because it's due unto you, God. We thank you, God. Have your way in this place, God. Hallelujah. We thank you. Hallelujah. It is so in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. Hallelujah. Glory to your name, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Come on, somebody, open up your mouth and begin to glorify the God of all gods. Amen. Of all kings, somebody, let's fill this room with an atmosphere of praise and worship to our Father. Come on, open up your mouth and begin to bless and magnify him. The Father, the word of the Lord declares, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. I've tasted this week. I've seen that he's been so, so good to me. Come on, don't stop, don't stop. Go ahead and take a couple moments and love on your Father. Go ahead and love on him, love on him, love on him. God, we love you. Hallelujah. Yeah. There's a shift in the room. Hallelujah. There's a shift in the room. There's a shift in the room. Oh. Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. Sing a new song unto the Lord. I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I'm expecting God to do something great in this service. The atmosphere is already set. If we never had to do another thing, I know the presence of the Lord is in this place. And when the presence of the Lord shows up, there is healing, signs, miracles, and wonders. I don't know about you, but I'm expecting God to do something supernatural in this house this morning. I'm expecting God to show up and show out on this first Sunday. It's Communion Sunday. It means that all things are passed away and all things have made new. Anybody under the sound of my voice that believes this morning that something's about to happen, shout hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. We welcome you this morning to Christian Tabernacle Church. And we welcome all those who visit us online. We're going to declare that our God reigns. He reigns supreme above every name. My God reigns. My God reigns. I need you to declare this song over every trial and over every problem. I need you to raise this up, church. I'll sing it. It's easy. It says, say, my God reigns. Our God reigns. Say, Lord, you reign above every name. Can you say it? Say, my God reigns. Our God reigns. Come on. Say, Lord, you reign above every name. Now sing it with me. With power and majesty, with power and majesty, dominion of say, with power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign. Oh, say, my God reigns, and our God reigns. Say, Lord, you reign above every name. Come on, say it with me. My God reigns, our God reigns. Say, Lord, you reign above every name. Now let's say it together with power. With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign. Yes, you do, Lord. With power and majesty, dominion, authority, you reign. Can we go up one more time, yo? Say, my God reign. Say, our God reign. Tell him, Lord, you reign above every name. Oh, my God reigns. Say, our God reign. Tell him, Lord, you reign above every name. Can we change the lyric now? Declare this. Over my circumstance, you've given me another chance, because you reign. Anybody glad about that this morning? Say it with me. Say, over my circumstance, you've given me another chance, because you reign. Can we say that again? Say, over my circumstance, over my circumstance, you've given me another chance, because you reign. Lord, over my circumstance, you've given me another chance. Why? Because you reign. Hallelujah. You reign. Come on, tell him, you reign. Can we say that as one mighty chorus? Come on, let's say, you reign. You reign. Come on, tell him, say, so you reign. Tell the Lord today, you reign. Yes, you do. Yes, you do. Let's say it again. You reign. Yes. You reign. Oh, God, you reign. You reign. You reign over depression. You reign over cancer. You stand supreme. You reign. Reign. I need somebody who knows that he reigns over every situation. Over my circumstance, you've given me another chance, because you reign. Somebody went to the hospital and the doctor said it was this, but God, I know that over my circumstance, you've given chance to show that you reign. I've been in that accident, but I'm still breathing. I can declare right now that over my circumstance, you've given me another chance, Lord, because you reign. They walked out on me. It's not the same way it was, but I can declare from this place that over my circumstance, you've given me another chance, because you reign. Now let's tell him one more time. Say, you reign. Come on, say, you reign. Come on, tell him, say, you reign. Come on, say, you reign. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Can we say it again? Come on, say, you reign. Hallelujah, over my problems. You reign. Oh, say, you reign. I bless you in this house, God. I give you glory, Lord, because you reign. Thank you. You reign. Now let's say, you still reign. Woo. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being God. Thank you for being God. Stay right there. Thank you for being God. Stay right there. Thank you for being God. Somebody just tell him thank you. Thank you for being God. I don't understand it, but I thank you for being God. I may not know what's coming next, but I thank you for being God. I thank you for being God. I thank you for being God. Yeah. understand why I'm going through what I'm going through, but I know that you know exactly what I'm going through. I thank you for being God. When the enemy comes against me on every side, I know that my God will lift up a standard, and so I can praise him even in the middle of trial, even in the middle of the test. I know I'm not alone, because he still reigns. Hey. As you reign, hey. As you reign, you still reign. Yes, you reign. I don't know why I can't let it go. Somebody needs to declare that you reign. Oh God, you still reign. I've been praying, I've been fasting, I've been asking, I'm expecting, and I can declare that even though I don't see it yet, you reign. You reign. You still reign. Anybody know that the victory belongs to Jesus in this house? My grandmother used to say, don't shout when the battle is over. You can shout right now. I need somebody in this house that knows that your victory is certain. I need you to shout right now if you know your victory is already secure. Who can stand against the Lord? No one can. No one will. The song is simple. It just says this. We give him glory. Who can stand against the Lord? No one. No one will. That's all the song says. We're just declaring this morning. Who will stand against our King? No one can. And no one will. Now we declare. Come on, say. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Hey. Victory belongs to him. That's all the song says, Tema. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to him. Can we just say that? Oh, everybody say, oh, come on. Oh, yes, we declare victory belongs to him. Come on, let's declare one mighty chorus. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to him. Let's say it from the top. Say, who can stand? Who can stand against the Lord? No one can. No one can. No one will. No one will. Whatever you say in your mouth, you gotta believe it, y'all. Come on, let's tell him. Say, who can stand against our King? Say, no one can. Oh God. And no one will. Come on, tell him now. Whoa. Victory belongs to him. Tell him again. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Come on, say, victory belongs to him. Yeah. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. I decree it now. Victory belongs to him. I believe it, Lord. Oh, oh, victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to him. Let me sing this for you. So we put our trust in you. say that to the Lord. Come on, say it.
So we put our trust in you.
Can we sing it? Come on.
So we put our hope in you.
Can we say that again? I need you to say it till you mean it.
So we put our trust in you.
No matter what the problem is.
So we put our hope in you.
One more time. Can you say it if you really mean it?
So we put our trust in you.
Oh.
So we put our hope in you.
I'll cry. I'll say
it.
Say it to the Lord.
Oh,
that's it. That's it. Come on, say it.
Oh,
that's it.
Victory belongs to Jesus.
I don't know what you need victory on. Come on, you gotta say it if you mean it.
Oh,
God, I put it in your hands. And
oh, I might cry, but victory belongs to Jesus.
Victory belongs to Jesus. To take whatever problem you're bearing to see.
Oh, 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 the victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Jesus. So I put my trust in.
That sounds good. That's it. Come on, Tom.
So I put my
thing you mean at this morning. So last time, that's it.
Victory belongs.
Somebody in this house is waiting on. Just keep singing that. Somebody needs to know that the victory belongs to him this morning. And I don't know what you need victory of, but I'm telling you, the victory belongs to Jesus. It's in Jesus. It's already been fulfilled. It's already existing. And all you need to do is grab hold of that name and grab hold of that truth and let that Spirit of Christ rise up within you. And you will experience victory over everything that you have a problem with. I'm not just saying that, I'm living that life. I'm seeing God blow my mind every single day as I exalt the name of Jesus. I'm beginning to see my response to situation changes. I'm beginning to see that my faith is rising. I'm beginning to see that I don't fight the battles the same way I fought them before, but I fight them victorious. I fight them with power, and I can cry out in the midnight hour knowing that he hears my cry, knowing that he responds to my cry, and know that he will fulfill every promise in my life today. Your trust in him. Take a moment to reflect on how faithful he is. Take a moment to give him everything. Just take a moment and love on him for a moment. You just said it. We put our trust in you. Now show him. Respond to him. Let him wash you. Let him clean you. Let him wipe it away. Let him carry you. Oh. tried so many things, and so I put my trust. And I know that you're the only answer, so I put my. You're the only healer, so heal, Lord. I put my trust in you. You're the only way maker, make ways in this house, Lord. Provider, provide in this house, oh, we put our trust in. You're the only deliverer, we put our hope in. You're the only provider, yeah, our trust in. You're the only healer, our hope in. So we put our trust, come on, so we. Trust in you. So we put our hope in you. Oh, oh, oh. Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him. To worship, go ahead and give God a victorious praise. Come on, go ahead and give Him a victorious praise. If that was for me, that would be okay, but go ahead and give Him a victorious praise. Come on, go ahead and open up your mouth, clap your hands, and give Him a victorious praise. Oh! Come on, open up your mouth and say, house. Now move the way you want to move. Have your way in the service. God, we put it out to you. Now pour back into us so much more. We give you glory. We give you honor. We give you praise, God. Somebody under the sound of my voice shout hallelujah. 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 You've officially been called to worship.
Victory belongs to Him. Victory belongs. Victory belongs to Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Victory over my circumstances. Victory over my situations. Victory over every struggle. Victory belongs to Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Victory. We put all our trust in Him. We put all our hope in Him. Hallelujah. Everything about our being is in Him. Oh God. Oh God. Oh God, thank God that victory belongs to Jesus. Hallelujah. Where would we be without victory in Jesus? Hallelujah. 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 He's here. All I can say is He's here. You better get yours before it moves beyond you. Hallelujah. Don't come all this way. Hallelujah to this place. Hallelujah. And the visitation is on. And you not leave here with victory in your life. Hallelujah. You may have come here struggling, beaten down, but you can leave here today with the victory, because victory belongs to Jesus. In spite of what the enemy tried to make you believe on this week, that you had failed, that you were a loser, that you missed the mark, I'm here to tell you this Sunday morning that victory belongs to Jesus. And you got the victory this morning. You are more than a conqueror. You are an overcomer this morning. Hallelujah. Victory belongs to Jesus. Victory belongs to Him. If you would please rest on your feet. If you would please rest on your feet. There's a fullness in this place this morning. There is a fullness and a pouring out in this place this morning. Open your hearts that you can receive what God has for His people. Hallelujah. The scripture reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 25, beginning at verse 35. For I was hungry, and you gave me something to eat. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you invited me in. I needed clothes, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you looked after me. I was in prison, and you came to visit me. Then the righteous will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you, or thirsty and give you something to drink? When did we see you a stranger and invite you in, or needing clothes and clothe you? When did we see you sick or in prison and go to visit you? The king will reply, I tell you the truth. Whatever you did for one of the least of these brothers of mine, you did for me. And this is the word of God. Hallelujah. We greet you this morning in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. On behalf of our illustrious Pastor Kevin T. Hart Sr. and First Lady Darlene Hart, we welcome you to the Christian Tabernacle Church of God. We invite you here to give praise and worship to Him who deserves all our praise and worship. Come on, people of God, and let's bless the Lord this morning. Let's give Him worship. Let's give Him praise. Let's give Him honor. For He is worthy. Hallelujah. You may be seated. Hallelujah. We do ask our visitors, if you are a visitor here this morning, we just want to acknowledge your presence and welcome you to this place. If you are a visitor, would you please stand at this time? Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We welcome you. We welcome you on behalf of Pastor Kevin, First Lady Darlene. We welcome you to the Christian Tabernacle Church of God. We want you to feel special, and so Christian Tabernacle, in our own way, please welcome our visitors and greet those who you have not greeted this morning. Youth Church will dismiss at this time.
Oh, the Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. The Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you. So easy. So easy.
Let's greet somebody this morning and say,
the Jesus in me loves the Jesus in you.
Is to engage, equip, and empower the world to become explosive disciples. Is this your first time at Christian Tabernacle? If so, we're glad to have you with us. Here at Christian Tabernacle, we're focusing on the critical seasons: connect, contribute, and celebrate. We've designed today's service with you in mind. In just a few moments, we'll sing a few songs, and then we'll hear a life-changing word. If you would like to get to know us a little better, please fill out the visitor information portion of the welcome packet and drop it in the offering bucket, or give it to one of our Love First technicians. Again, thank you for coming today. We hope that you enjoy your time here. Oh, and by the way, here's what's happening at the Tab. Get ready, get ready, get ready. We are entering into Master Life 4, the Disciples Mission, which will be facilitated by Minister LaMisha Smith. Come for a great discussion as we continue to dig deeper in the Word of God. Please see Reverend Rufus Riddick for your books. Books are available for $10. We look forward to learning and growing together. Lights, camera, action. The Generation Next Youth Ministry will display a mini fashion show during our Youth Sunday celebration on December 23rd. If you are interested in modeling, assisting with the setup and breakdown, or just lending a helping hand as needed, please see Youth Council Member Kevin Hart Jr. or Minister LaMisha Smith for more information. What better way to cap off the holiday season than to join the Tab on Friday, December the 7th at 7:30 p.m. for the One Night Strong Finish Revival. Pastor Antoine Hutchins from Christian Unity Baptist Church will be our guest speaker. I don't think you want to miss this one. Be the one to bring one. Mark your calendars, Tab's friends and family. Connect, contribute, and celebrate with us here at the Tab on Sunday, December 9th at 3:30 p.m. for an ordination service for Elder-elect Rufus Riddick. The ordination service will take place over at New Bethel Baptist Church. The address for New Bethel Baptist Church, 1739 9th Street, Northwest, Washington, D.C.
The Women of the Word presents.
The Women of the Word is calling all ladies to celebrate with them on December 14th at 7 p.m. for a holiday Christmas party. Ladies interested in signing up, please be sure to see Minister Crystal Wooten or Sister Faye Green. This is a follow-up to the mountaintop meeting and a holiday celebration. Each attendee is asked to bring a $15 gift for a woman. This will be a great time in the Lord as we bring in the holiday season.
Please remember that the Tabitha Transportation Ministry is available to serve you. If you desire to be picked up, please call the church office each week by Wednesday at noon. If you want to stay up to date and connected with us, give us a like on Facebook, follow us on Twitter, check us out on YouTube, or tell those who missed out about our frequently updated live feed. This concludes our weekly announcements. We thank you again for coming to see us. We pray that you have a great and remember, Tab family, we are touching to transform.
Amen. Come on, let's give God some praise. Amen. Amen. God is awesome, and He is worthy to be praised. Amen. Amen. I tell you, I'm just so grateful that God still decided to use me in spite of me. And sometimes when I wake up in the morning, man, I just look around me and I just get overwhelmed sometimes because I know I shouldn't be here. But God stuck to His word even then when I didn't stick to mine. So I thank Him for that. And sometimes we're looking for tangible things to give God praise before we can give God a praise. But sometimes you just need to take some deep breaths and say, God, I thank you. God, I thank you. Amen. We also want to continue. Good to see Deacon Butler made it back. Amen. Amen. With his family. They've been away on some R&R on this Tuesday. Deacon Butler will be laying his father to rest at Stewart Funeral Home. The viewing is from 10 to 11, and the services begin at 11. We ask that all that can go by just as a way of supporting one of our faithful brothers here, just to strengthen them, amen, just to love on them and let them know that they're not going through this by themselves. Amen, 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 amen. Also, it's good to see Sister Millicent in the back of the house. Amen. 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 She called me. She texted me and said, FYI, I'm in the hospital. I told her, next time something going on with you and I got to find about it on Facebook, it's going to be on. Amen. It's going to be on. So, yeah, she said, Pastor, I just don't want to worry you. I said, those are the things that I need to know, you know. You know, I mean, it's the other stuff that, you know, but yeah, just let me know, because we want to know what we need to target our prayers at and let you know that you're a family. You know, you don't just come here and join no church. You are part of a family. Amen. And we care about you. Amen. Amen. With no strings attached. Amen. So we just want to know that we're praying for those over there. A lot of us, I'm praying for the Bush family. And the loss of our president, our former president, George Bush, the way that he loved his wife and the way that they loved each other, man, was impeccable. He was a relational president. He reached across party lines. And this is not a partisan moment. This is a bipartisan moment where when you see someone who have served their country for so long and to see them transition like this, you feel for the family. So we're lifting up the Bush family. His wife just passed away in April, and now today they are preparing to say farewell to President Bush. So we want to keep them in prayer. We want to keep this country in prayer. Amen. Amen. If we won't pray, who can we expect to pray? Amen. Amen. So we again, also, I wanted to remind you all that on this Friday night, all leaders, all members, all friends, all visitors. We want to see you out this Friday night at 7:30 for our Strong Finish Revival, amen, with Pastor Antoine Hutchins, amen. For those of you all who have never heard Pastor Hutchins preach, amen, this will be a treat for you, amen. Amazing, amazing preacher who just happens to graduate from Virginia Union University, amen, amen, amen. So we ask you to come out, be on time. Doors of the church will be opening at 7, so we're asking that everyone will be here on time. Third Sunday, please invite your friends and your family. It's going to be brunch at the tab, amen. We're going to break down this space. We're going to have the table set up, and we're going to serve you brunch and worship at the same time. Amen, amen. We're going to serve you some brunch, and we're going to worship at the same time. Amen. So we're excited. I just every time I see Sister Kim over there on the door, I be thinking, she'll be looking for the bus, but it's amen, amen, amen. But it's good. I tell you, sometimes how you know that God takes you from glory to glory to glory. Amen. Amen. Where you are is not where you will finish. I don't know. That's prophetic. I don't know. But where you are is not where you will end. Amen. So we are excited how God is growing us as we go through this master life. This master life has been blessing the people of God. I came Tuesday night, and I was blessed. I'll be back this Tuesday night, I tell you. Amen. Amen. I'm telling you, I was just excited, man, for all of the teachers that have taught this year. We thank you for your diligence, amen, and your study. Amen. Amen. We need you to update if you have not updated your impersonal information, please update this to today, and give it to one of our Love First technicians, because we want to make sure that we can get all the communication that needs to get to you. For those of you all that have been giving all year long, we want to make sure that you get your statements to the right address. Amen. Every year we get returned mail because people have moved and have not made us aware of it. So take a few moments. If anything has changed with your personal information, please update it and turn it in to one of our loves. If you need one, just slip your hand up. They'll get you one. Amen. Amen. We want to make sure that everyone has everything that they need. Amen. Amen. Also, the women, don't forget to make sure that the women are having a party. Amen. Over at the Williams house. That's our Sister Taria Williams. Amen. I want all y'all go. Amen. All y'all go. Sister Taria Lightfoot, formerly Lightfoot, now Williams. I need everybody. All y'all go over there, man, and have a good time. Amen. We ask everyone bring at least a $15 gift. Take a gift with you and go over and just have a good time. For my men, the men will be singing third Sunday in January. That is a correction. It's the third Sunday in January, and we already have the rehearsal set aside. The second and the third Thursday, we will be rehearsing here at the church. I need all my brothers to come out. We starting it off. We kicking it off because the women coming back in February. Amen. So we want all my brothers to be out the second and the third Thursday of the month for our rehearsal so that we can serve in excellence. Amen. We're going to make sure, Theo, just make sure that you keep Brother Devon away from his own mic. Amen. 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 Brother Devon, get a hold of that mic. We in trouble. Amen. 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 We are excited about what the Lord is doing. Listen, this offering time, we're not going to keep you here long. Amen. It's offering time. You need an envelope. I love first technicians. Just slip your hand up. I love first technicians can serve you. Amen. We're in a series this day, so I want to kind of jump right back in this series. Amen. On effective evangelism. Amen. And we also have communion. Amen. 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 If you need an envelope, I love first technicians can serve you. For those of you all that don't have your checks or your cash, you can also pick up your cell phone. And you can text the give at 202-759-4044. 202-759-4044. Also, you can go to our website at ctcoginc.org and you can give that way, or you can cash app to @thetabdc. Amen. Those are ways that you can give here. Amen. When you have your offerings, everyone just stand all over the building. Even if you don't have a tangible gift, but you just have a desire to give, amen. We pray that God will bless you and meet you at your desires. Amen. 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 Father, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your mercies. We thank you because without you, there is no us. You are necessary. We are contingent. So, Father, we bless you on today, God. Father, we thank you for every giver on today, God. Father, we even thank you for those that didn't have a tangible gift to give on today, God, but they had a desire and a heart to give, God. Father, we pray, God, that you meet them at their heart's desire, God. Father, we also pray, God, that you that every seed meets every need before every need even becomes a need. Father, this is our prayer, God. We believe it lines up with your will. So, God, we believe we have what we asked of you. In Jesus' name, amen. Everyone just say, God, I thank you. I love for it. Say, yeah, 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 yeah.
Come on, I hear you. Come on.
Say, yeah, 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 yeah.
Say it.
Everybody say, yeah. Yeah. For the devil is defeated, we are blessed. Say it again, we're blessed in the city, and we're blessed in the field. Come on, and we're blessed when we come, when we go. We cast down every stronghold, sickness and poverty must cease. For the devil is defeated.
God comes forth. Just want to remind you that God is our strength. The word of God declares that he's a very present help in times of trouble. I'm looking around me and I'm paying attention to the news a whole lot more. And every now and again, I just got to turn it off and remind myself that no matter how the times of trouble seem to be all around me, and my strength does not come from anything on this earth. My strength comes from the Lord. Amen. This little song says, you are my strength. Yes. Strength like no other. I hear you. I hear you. Strength like no other. Now you singing this morning. Come on, say, reaches to me. I need you to tell yourself when you're weak and worn out, tell her, you are my strength. Oh God.
God, yes you are. Strength like no other. I can count on you. Strength like no other. Deacon Butler, this one's for you. Reaches to me. When I lost my dad, I had to sing this song over myself for many days. And you are my strength. And God stepped in. Strength like no other. Oh, strength like no other. Reaches to me. You know, when you feel weak and worn out and hopeless, say, you are my hope. I can count on you. Hope like no is how you flood me with your presence and says, in the fullness of your grace and in the power of your name. What do? You lift me up. Oh, yes, you do. Come on, say, you lift me up. Come on, can we sing it again? Say, in the fullness of your grace, oh God, is in the power of your name. You lift me up, oh Lord. You lift me up. Can we say this? You are my joy. You are my joy. Oh, joy like no. Time. You are my peace in the middle of the storm. You are my peace, yes. Peace like no other. Oh God, I thank you. Peace like no other. Reaches to me. Reaches to me. Now let's declare it. In the fullness of your grace, you lift me up. In the fullness of your grace. Thank you. It's in the power of your name. You lift me up. You lift me up. Oh, I'm coming up now. You lift me up. You lift me up. Come on, say it again. In the fullness of your grace. It's in the power. Unfailing love. I need somebody to know this morning. It's stronger than mountains. And no matter what you've done, it's deeper than oceans. And this morning it's here. It reaches to me. One more time. Unfailing. When everybody else walks out on you, it's stronger than mountains. And no matter what you've done, it's still deeper than oceans. And that love is reaching to you this morning. Reaches to me. Come on, Pastor. Song says, it's in the fullness of your in the power of your name. You lift me up. Oh, I'm coming up now. You lift me up. You lift me up. One last time. Come on.
just tell him.
Hey. It's in the fullness of your grace. It's in the power of your name. You lift me up.
Let you fall. He won't let you fail. He won't let you fail. He lifts you up. When all else forsake you, God will be there. Not to kick you down, not to throw it in your face, but to lift you up. Yeah. Luke chapter 14. I got the move. Luke chapter 14.
Blessed is he who shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then he said to him, a certain man gave a great supper and invited many and sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were already invited, come, for all things are now ready. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. The first one said to him, I have bought a piece of land, I bought a piece of ground, bought me a new house, bought me a new car, and I must go and just look at it. I ask that I have, that I may be excused. Another one said, I've just bought 5 yoke of oxen and now I'm going to drive it. I just bought me a new Bentley, I'm going to drive it. I just bought me a new car. I ain't got time to come to the feast because I'm going to test it out. I asked that I may be excused. Still another one says, I just married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So the servant came and reported these things to his master. And then the master of the house, being angry, don't miss that. Don't miss that. Being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city and bring in here the poor, the crippled, the lame, and the blind. And the servant said, Master, it is done as you commanded, and still there is enough room. Then the master said to the servant, go out into the hedges and the highways and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say to you, none of those who were invited shall taste my supper. Amen. I want to just go back up and just deal with the second piece of that. Last week we dealt with the first piece, and we're still dealing with the subject in the series, Effective Evangelism. Father, we thank you this morning. We thank you, God, for your presence is so relevant and so present in our lives today, God. We ask, God, that you would hide me behind the cross so that I, too, myself might marvel at your word. Revelation, knowledge, and clarity of speech is my prayer. Pray that lives are changed, hearts are fixed, and relationships are restored. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. We talked about this last week. We talked about it last week. We talked about effective evangelism. Effective evangelisms that yields results. We talked about how Jesus was at the table. He was at a table with the Pharisees, the very people who were plotting to set him up. He was sitting at the table, but he maintained his composure even in the presence of people that were trying to persecute him. He maintained his composure. He did not let the atmosphere. He was not a thermos. He was not a thermometer. He was a thermostat. He did not allow them to dictate how he responded, knowing that everybody at the table were out to get him. They were trying to catch him in some type of trick bag. Is it not lawful to heal on the Sabbath? And Jesus knew what they were up to, but Jesus did not allow being at the table with people who were hating on him, people who didn't want to see him do better, people that were hoping your marriage or fail. He did not allow people that were in his presence to dictate how he acted at the table. He kept to his assignment, and he began to share stories. He began to say, is it lawful for me to heal somebody? Because he had just healed somebody, and he said, what if it was your child that was sick and needed a doctor? Would you wait till tomorrow morning when the doctor's office opened, or would you immediately interrupt the service and ask everybody to focus their attention on somebody I love? Oh, say if it was your oxen that fell sick, would you not care for that? Because this is the way you pay your bill. Your oxen is your bulldozer. This is how you do your business. This is how you pay your bills. What if your money was in jeopardy because of something? Would you wait until Monday and hope that you can figure it out? No, you would deal with it in the moment. Jesus went on to say, even if you throw a banquet, do not invite your friends, your family, or the rich people, because they might be able to invite you back. And then you have been repaid. But what I want you to do is I want you to invite the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame, those who cannot repay you, because your reward will be at the resurrection. He went on and he started. One of them says, well, it would be great for those to enjoy your feast in the resurrection and in the kingdom. And he says, there was a certain man. He talked about that certain man. We shared this last week, that the certain man means it could have been you. So what God was trying to do, he was trying to put you in his place. Sometimes because we say, oh, I'm not God. So God, I'm God, I ain't gonna act like that. But God wanted you to put you in his place. He says, what if you threw a banquet? What if you went through all of this preparations, all of this detail, spent all of this money and sacrificed so much time to prepare something for people, and then when you go and tell them that it's ready, they make excuses.
See, God ain't gonna get angry. The Bible says, angry, be angry, but not sin. But it says, he says, wouldn't you be mad, James, if you came up and you prepared everything, and then when you start inviting people that you thought were enough, grateful enough because of what you've done for them, and they don't show up, they give you an excuse, wouldn't you be mad? He says, a certain man. He says, I want you to understand how I feel sometimes when you make excuses as about why you can't do certain things. I want you to know how God, can I tell y'all sometimes how God feels when we make all of these excuses as to why we can't serve him? After all that he has done for us, after all that he's went through, he went into the details of making sure that everything that he has done for us was perfectly set out for us, and then we make excuses. We talked about it last week, Brother Willie, that effective evangelism does not begin in the community, it begins in the house. How can you go give people good news about something that you don't even frequent regularly? That's why we got a lot of confused folk in the street, believing in process theology that God evolves. God is, he's learning from us. God doesn't learn from us. That's why we got so many people confused, because you're trying to share something that you don't know yourself. Oh, I don't have to go to church. God is in me. Man, listen. Okay, let me. But I need to tell you that it's, forget not the assembling of the Bishop Wesley Cherry preached it about 7-8 years ago, and he preached it backwards, and Sylvia Bailey always talk about that message today. He preached that text backwards, and he talks about you gotta show up, because at the show up, you get the information, you get the instructions. When we don't show up, we don't get the proper information, so we're out there giving people stuff that we're not even informed about. So it says it begins out, but also it says, but effective evangelism is associated with selfless servants. God said, when everything was made ready, when everything was prepared, he didn't pick the person that he can't count on to do nothing. He picked somebody that was serving. He said, I need you to go out. Why? Because I can trust you to inform folk that you didn't invite. He said, I need somebody that it was people around the table that was tasting and that was enjoying the meal around the table, but he didn't even pick those people. He picked somebody that was serving the table. He said, because truth be told, most of the people that's around the table, eating from the table, you can't trust to go serve folk. He said, I need to see who will get up from this feast and serve other folk in my presence, then those are the ones that I know I can send out to inform folk that everything has been ready for them. If you can't serve in the house, why you always want to show up on third Saturday down the park? If you can't serve on Sunday, I'm just coming here eating and feasting, those are not the people that need to go and serve. It is the people that can serve people in the presence of God. He said he chose a selfless servant, though someone who esteemed others higher than himself, who were more concerned about others than he was himself. Because I knew if I was looking out for the least of these, if I was serving these, God got me covered. We said selfless servants means that the word servant in the Greek in ministry, it means to minister to. The word minister means to wait on tables. So those of us that are serving are those that are waiting on tables. And you know how some of us are when we go to, we are some of the hardest folk to serve when we go out to restaurants. I tell you, I don't like going out, so forgive me, I can't go out to eat with everybody because I just can't deal with certain people when you are in a service environment and that's the only way they get paid. I can't deal with folk that keep sending your food back, looking for a reason to get a discount. Why did you come out to eat if you ain't have enough to pay for it? I can't deal with folk that need to see the manager because the spoon is dirty. Ask for another spoon. I'm sorry, that's just me. I'm sorry. That's why I can't go out to eat with everybody, because I can't, because these are service jobs, and these people depend on your tips. Watch this, to provide for their families, and you go there and you make serving hard for them. Okay, let me bring it from the restaurant and bring it back to the church. And you make serving hard for folk when you come in here and you ain't got nothing to do but can complain about this fan has got a rip in it. You make service hard, but God looks for the people that even when folk are hard to serve, they still serve. But only not only is it waiting on tables, it means that, watch this, even when they finish, you got to come up and you got to clean the table for them, preparing for the next person that shows up. What does that look like? That looks like when church is over, you're not waiting for Mr. James to come in here tomorrow morning to pick up the food that you ate today. Oh, don't worry about James to get it tomorrow. No, clean up. That's what true service is. You don't wait for somebody else to come do. You see a need and you serve. Why? Because you're preparing for the next people that come in the door. It's like waiting on tables. But watch this. This is the reason why we do it. The reason why we don't do it is because when we don't do it, he said, because pastors don't say my name over the pulpit. He gives everybody else credit, but he don't know I was the one that picked it up in the back. And I don't need you to text me, tell you, I just stopped by the church and cleaned up. Eh? You must have just missed me because I was out there shoveling the snow before you left here. You see what I'm saying? But one of the things, a selfless servant knows that no matter if you don't give, if you don't celebrate him, if you don't tip him, if you don't reward him, he knows that gratuity is included because he's really not serving you, he's serving the kingdom. That's why when you go in restaurants and you got a party of eight or more, they don't care how much you argue. They don't care how much you complain because their gratuity is already included in the tip. And it's one thing to understand that God rewards you openly for what you do. And you got to stop, because truth be told, too many of us are chasing folk outside the restaurant because they didn't leave a tip, coming back to find out that somebody else done snatched what you chasing after. And God says the gratuity is included. Why are you chasing folk for a tip? Chasing folk down the street talking about something you ain't say thank you. Oh, I can't serve these folks. I just can't deal. I'm not there yet. That's why he ain't choose you to go out and serve. Effective evangelism is associated with people that first of all, if you can serve in my presence, when everybody is feasting, everybody's eating, getting full, going home, and you are sitting here serving, those are the people that God can trust to send out. But effective, watch this. And so effective evangelism is waiting on tables, but it's also someone that he can trust to inform people. See, one of the problems, one of the things that we do is we wanna have input on the invitation list. But truth be told, the reason why he didn't allow you to have input on the invitation list because you would exclude who God was trying to include. Oh no, they can't come. But you don't know nothing about them? You ain't hear about that? You holding unforgiveness in your heart, so everybody you don't forgive ain't invited to the party. But God wants to know if he can trust. He wants to find somebody who don't care who's invited. My only job is to only go and be a messenger. That's why he said, you're not inviting nobody. You don't invite nobody to my party. I put up and I take down. He said, all I need you to do is go be a prophetic voice and say what I tell you to say. I don't need you to look on the external. That's why Samuel, that's why the oil, he's looking on the external servant. No, he surely can't be a king. Surely this is not the one. Ain't that what he said? Surely this is the one because of how he looks. He said, but you look on the external, I look on the heart. That's why you can't. That's why I didn't need your input on the invitation, because you're looking on surface stuff. You look on people that, you know, pray out in public, all these babbling. That's surely that's the no. You ain't getting no brownie points because you get up and you can speak in all this. He says, if you don't love and you making all these pray down power. Oh, you know the text. You got all this stuff. You ain't nothing but a clanging cymbal. Stop looking at folk that are eloquent with words. That's why you wanted. Okay, so today. He says, I want you to go and tell them that all things have been made ready. Now, this is what you must understand as a selfless servant. As a selfless servant, in order to be effective in evangelism, you cannot allow other people's excuses to render you useless. Yeah. It's in the text. Because truth be told, some of us feel inadequate because other people reject us. It's in the text. So it says, but they all with one accord began to make excuses. He says, God told me to come tell you that all things are ready for you. Okay, let me say that again. God told me to tell you that all things have been ready for you, and now you are making excuses. He said, one of them said, I have bought a piece of ground and I must go see it. I'm not even going to go and work on it. I'm just going to see what I bought. Okay. The next one says, I bought some oxen to quit it today. I just bought me a new car. I'm going to take my family down on the beach. I can't get time. Other one said, I just got a wife and I ain't got time. But whatever you put before God, you lose it. And so what happens is the servant does what most of us do, run back to the house. I went there and I told them that all things was ready and all of them made excuses. I'm coming home. It's dangerous out there. It's ugly. He said, I told you not to send me out there anyway because I wasn't qualified. Moses. And you got to be careful because sometimes when other people give you excuses, it makes you feel like you're inadequate. It makes you feel like you're useless. And the only reason why you even telling them was because God sent you. Truth be told, if God hadn't sent me, I wouldn't even be talking to you. Okay, y'all missed that right here. Because truth be told, people get it twisted. People got a whole bunch of excuses, and they think you comfortable in doing this. They think this comes in. No, the only reason why I'm even talking to you is because God sent me. Because if it was up to me, I wouldn't even be talking to you. But because I'm trying to please him and not please you, I'm trying to tell you that everything is ready. Do you understand when God sends you out, he knows what your weakness and he knows your strength, and you got to stop allowing other people to make you feel like you're not qualified to be talking to certain groups or you're not qualified. And he says they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting him. Don't get off the outreach ministry because nobody listened to you last time. You got to be careful because what happened is people will make you feel worthless, of no use, valueless, ineffective, impractical, fruitless, unproductive, ineffectual, unworkable, unavailing, unsuitable for what God has called you to do. Stop allowing people's rejection to cause you to become dejected. No way in the world I'm supposed to be here preaching to this group. But God told me to do it, so I'm going to do it. I'm not the most qualified. But I'm not going to let you telling me no and not coming to church make me feel like I need to go do something else. The devil is a liar. Because if God has called me to, whether none of y'all show up, he's got a plan. Stop allowing other people's excuses. Because watch this, one of the most frustrating, one of the biggest frustrations, irritations, and agitations is to have people that have seen his presentation to not accept his invitation. Watch this. Okay, let me, I'm done. This is gonna be it. Next week, we're gonna move on. But let me tell you this. The people he was inviting, that's why he says, stop inviting your friends and your family. Because they get too familiar with you. And they're gonna always make excuses. Watch this. Because, okay, what this text was saying was a certain man. He says, I want you to get in my shoes and see how I feel. He said, because these are the Israelites. Who are the Israelites? God's chosen people. These are not just anybody. These are people that I saved, that I set apart. These are people that I raised up as my people. And these are the same people that when Pharaoh was working their behinds like a slave, whooping and killing and stealing and doing everything to them, I came in and I brought them out of captivity. And these are the same people that's making excuses. It says that when he came back and told him, he says, and the master got angry. These are people that saw me lead them in a pillar of cloud by day, in a pillar of fire by night, bring them through on dry ground through a Red Sea, then to see me rain down quail and manna on them, and now they still making excuses. How do you think I feel? They're not rejecting you, they're rejecting him. These are not people that have not tasted and been exposed to his power. These are people that have seen God make a way. But they still making excuses. These are not people that have not benefited from the presence of God. These are not people that have not seen God show up, open doors that no man can shut, make a way, and be the way. These are people that only reason why they got land to go see is because God blessed them. Oh, let me show you something. You must understand, he says, these, some of the most ungrateful people are the most graceful people. I got that, okay? Y'all need to write that down. If y'all don't write nothing down, matter of fact, y'all need to tweet that today. Some of the most ungrateful people are graceful people. People that are full of God's unmerited favor, stuff they don't deserve. But because God keeps blessing us in spite of us, we think it's us and we forget that it's him and we really don't deserve this and we're full of grace and now we become ungrateful because we've been living off grace and not favor. I know I'm going to get in trouble because I say this all the time, because if there is an unmerited favor, then there is a merited favor. Okay, y'all. Can I tie this in real quick? See, some of us, we done got beside ourselves and said, God has favored me. God has smiled. He ain't smiling on you. He doing it in spite of you, and that's called grace because he's giving you stuff that you really don't deserve. And now that you are living in a house that you didn't build, and now that you driving a car that you really couldn't afford, now you done got beside yourself, and you ain't got time to show up to the person that gave it to you in the first place. Some of the most is folk that don't even deserve to be sitting where you sitting today, and you get this, I ain't got time. That's what they were saying. The only reason why you got land to go see is because you were one of the Israelites and God blessed you in spite of you. The heart, when you were in captivity, he came out and brought you out of captivity. You weren't in captivity. You were not wrongly charged. You were not in there. DNA was not wrong. You did it and he still delivered you. But while you were in prison, you had a jailhouse religion saying, when I get out of here, I'm going to serve you. But as soon as you get out and you get a couple of coins, you forget about God and you ain't got time to show up. We got jailhouse preachers in the church today. They come in here and they got bondage in their house and they say, God, if you just deliver this, when you deliver me, I'm going to show up. And as soon as he does it, we ain't got time. It ain't just happening in Jessup. It ain't just happening on Rikers Island. People talking about talking that good call, giving, running up your collect phone ball bill, talking about God. I get it all the time. They call me all the time. Pastor, I'm telling you, where God get up. And soon they, I can't find them. Because we got a jailhouse religion in church. The only time we can lift up our hands and praise and shout is when stuff is wrong. I'm going to praise my way through this. As soon as you get through it, you got excuses. That's a prison praise. Too many Christians got prison praise, but when God brings you out of prison, you got a bunch of exile excuses. You got a bunch of excuses as to why you can't serve God when he's been so good to you, when you didn't deserve his goodness. And then you got people that are coming to only tell you that everything is ready. And now people are going back into the, first of all, God uses people that other people would not use. And now they already having a problem because they introvert. And you asking me to go out here and expose myself and be vulnerable to people. And they keep rejecting me. Brother Vaughn, this is what they do. This is what you got to do. If you're going to be effective evangelism, you cannot allow other people's excuses to make you feel useless. Maybe that's why people not coming to the church, because we keep going after the same people that got excuses. We keep going after graceful people. Don't worry about them, because the Bible's clear. Shall I continue in sin that grace may abound? We keep trying to recycle Christians. And God has not called us to recycle Christians. He says, go out into the world and make disciples and go everywhere. Stop just trying to go to folk that know how to read the Bible. Go to folk that ain't never touched the Bible. The kingdom is not getting bigger. We're just getting recycled. The church is not growing. Statistics are showing that the church is not dying. The church is this people that's been recycled are now tired of you putting them in a recycle bin for them to come back and go. No, God is saying, go to folk that don't know me. The churches are conducive for recycling, but not renewing. We got to understand this. If you're going to be effective, you got to go. And when folk reject you, they're not rejecting you, they're rejecting him. You're only a messenger. He comes back in the house, Brother Devon. This is what he does. He comes back in the house, and it says that the master got angry. This is what he says, Deacon Michaels. He says the master got mad and says, go out and bring in the poor, the cripple, the blind, and the lame. This is what he said. Quickly. I'm not going to allow a bunch of ungrateful folk cause me to waste what I've done for them. Everything is ready. Go out and get the poor. Watch this. Next point. So what he's saying is, if we're going to be effective in evangelism in 2019, the church must become an ecosystem of social change. I know y'all ain't get that. The church, in order to be effective, because church folk ain't coming, folk that's been present, folk that's been privy to his power are not coming, folk that you think should be grateful enough to come not coming. So what we gonna do, just sit here amongst each other having church? He says, no, you gotta create an ecosystem of social change. What is an ecosystem? An ecosystem is a community of like-minded people that are changing the world socially. The church must become an ecosystem. Everybody must start thinking alike. We must start having the same mindset. We must start having the same view. We must create a culture of people. It says a community that is about social change. If not, we're going to keep being frustrated because folk not going to respond to our information that we're giving them. He said, so what we must do is we got to stop fighting with that family member that know that you know so much about that God delivered them from cancer and they won't come to church. Stop fighting with them folk. If they don't want to come to church, don't come. He says, create an ecosystem of social change. And he says, go out and bring in the poor. Do you see what he says? Do you see what he says? He says, you are going out, we are going out, and we are informing people, and they're not responding to our invitation, or they're not responding. And so what happens is, he says, don't worry about it. This food will be eaten. He says, what I prepared will be enjoyed. He says, and you remember this? What the Bible says, when the Israelites refused me and rejected me, I offered it to the salvation to the Gentile. He says, don't worry about them. Now I'm going to offer it to the Gentile. He says, I need you to go out and create an ecosystem in community, in the church, where we are about social change. He says, I need you to go out, and I need you to provide social services. I'm teaching. This should be Tuesday night. You don't want to know how? He says, so that my table shall be full. He wants us to be full. But the only reason why we're not full is because we've targeted the wrong audience. We target folk that we think can do something back for us. I tell people all the time, when I came up, my dad and them, I kind of push away from that model, because we go fellowship with this church and we take $1,000, and you come back and fellowship with me and you bring me $1,000. We recycling church folk in money. And while all the poor, the crippled, the blind, and the lame have no social support. I done had preachers to say, Pat, I used to fellowship with your dad. I said, good. You need me to come preach for you, I'll come preach for you. I come on a Sunday morning, I'll come. But I'm not bringing no whole bunch of people, no offering. Then you're going to expect me to invite you back, because that's not what he's saying. We've got so comfortable with antiquated models of doing church that now we are leaving out the people that he's calling us to. I only came in to seek and save the lost. I'm coming for the poor. But we keep recycling thousands of dollars amongst church folk, and none of the money is spilling over into the communities where people need it. The bills are paid at the church, but people right around the corner getting set out. I don't need you to come to my church at 4 o'clock on Sunday morning. Meet me up in the community at Saturday at 4. And the offering we take, let's give it to them. I'm trying to get you to understand that's kingdom. If Jesus came to our churches today, he would not recognize what we're doing, because it's not what he told us to do. It's dogmas that we have created, and you wonder why the community don't trust the church, because nothing is spilling from in the church into the community. He says, I need you. He said, go quickly. But let me tell you what's going to come, and I'm just going to give you an overview, but next week, let me tell you what's going to happen if we're really going to be true to this effective evangelism. What it means is, he's saying that the first group of people I want you to go to, you won't have to bring them. It's in the text. Gwen, it's in the text. He says, I need you to bring the poor. Because everybody don't have what it takes to get here by themselves. He says, so we got to create a budget. We got to create a culture that we have the resources to bring the people that can't get here by themselves. If that means putting in a handicap ramp, because the churches are no longer handicap accessible and is only welcoming for the well. The only people that are welcome are the folk that are well, that can get here on their own, that got enough money to pay for a cab, that got Uber on each phone. Those people are the only people that the church is welcoming to. But what about the folk that want to come but they can't get here? He said, you're going to have to bring them. Let me show you what the word, let me show you what the poor. Let me show you the poor. Let me show you what the poor. He said, because what happened is, he says, they have become stigmatized. Watch this. He says, But the Bible says, come to me all who are burdened and heavy laden, I will give you rest. What has happened is that there has been a culture of classism, nationalism, and sexism that only certain people are welcoming into our churches. And he says, watch that. And the only thing they need is somebody that's willing to do what it takes to just get me here. Just get me here. I want to come. Just get me here. I want to come. But we see them, watch this. The word poor talks about people without possessions or wealth. Watch this. Considered a group. I got to go. The cripple. We're going to dig deeper than this. Let me just give you this. The poor people. So why didn't Jesus just say all the people with issues? Why did he have to identify who he wanted you to go at? Why? Because everybody don't need the same stuff. The church has generalized its service to the community, and they're giving people with brand new shoes new shoes. We are doing what we want to do and not what needs to be done. And you want to know why we are not effective and effective? He says, I need you to go to the poor. Some people don't have the resources. And the way you're going to serve the poor, sure, you serve the individual, but you get to the systemic reason of how they fell into poverty. Oh, God, y'all don't want to hear that. So truthfully, Doc, you mean to me, I can't just give you money, but I got to deal with the systemic issue as why is there disproportionate funding in your community and why you can't get a job and why you're dealing with collateral consequences and sentencing guidelines. Why? Because you have a criminal felony record. Now you're blocked from getting a housing. Why? We gotta stop coming to church, and we got to put some protest to our piety, and we got to start bringing the poor. No, this ain't really what they want to hear on Sunday morning. He says, the cripple. See, watch this. Watch this, Brother Theo. He says, the reason why I identified the cripple is because everybody, the cripple of people that are people, crippled people, often offensive, is a partially disabled person. Unable to use one or more limb. They have limitations. Watch this. They are not the lame. The lame can't do nothing for themselves. These are people that just need a little help. A crippled person just can get here, but they don't have a crutch. They don't have a hand. They don't have a hand. We got to learn how to serve you. Everybody don't need everything. Some people just need a little help. And truth be told, some of us know if we just had a little help a long time ago, we would have been here a long time ago. And the blind people are the people without a vision. And then the lame people, the people that are just no strength. These are our community. But watch this, what it says for all of them. And all of them, guess what it says? They usually hang in groups. I'm done. Let's go. I'm done. Because we have a colonized consciousness. And poor people gravitate to poor people. Crippled people gravitate to crippled people. Lame people gravitate to lame people. And we stigmatize them, and we have a colonized consciousness as the church, and they say, why do they need health care? They're going to die anyway. It's a colonized consciousness where we look on communities and we see them as a whole, and we don't think what we're going to do is going to help anyway. It's a colonized consciousness. The church has a colonized consciousness. And we don't go in and bring them. Why? Because we don't think they want to be brought. Stand. Let's go. We done. I know I kind of went there today, Brother Willie. But I want us to be effective. I want us to be effective. It's time for people to stop running around the church. But God can't get you to move with haste into the community. When are we going to start? Watch this. Brother Mike, in Ezekiel 37, he told Ezekiel, all I need to do is speak to the dry bones, prophesy to them, say what I tell you to say. And it says, when you engage the poor, the crippled, the blind and the lame, it says they will stand on their own two feet. So you mean to tell me the only thing that's keeping people from standing on their own feet, even though they poor, even though they crippled, even though they, is because we won't bring them? Well, Pastor, we ain't got gas for the bus. Here, man, go put some gas in that bus. If that's the only thing that's keeping you from bringing somebody that needs to get to church, here, don't talk to me about not having gas on the bus. Don't talk to me about, well, I ain't going that way. You ain't going that way. Well, here, let me give you $20. I'm going to tell you, people say, Pastor, you're always paying for, because I don't want nobody that want to be here not to get here. People tell me, Pastor, why you pay so many? He says, you attach payment to priority. You want to know why Derry's working all week long? Because the Bible is clear. How can you hear without a faith? Faith come by hearing. If you can't hear, then you can't have faith. And Derry's is our sound guy. It's important. Stop paying folk that's doing a job that's not important. But when we put a priority on the right things, and the right things is bringing people that need to get to the feast. God is trying to get you to the feast. But we ain't got time to bring the poor. We want to keep inviting folk that's doing good. You know why? Because we don't want to renovate this place and make it handicap accessible. It's time for the church to stop only being welcoming to the well. Because guess what? You weren't well when you got here. You came dragging. You weren't smelling like that when you came here. I remember how some of us smelled. You ain't get here by yourself. Some of us came straight from the crack house because one of our family members came and said, you bringing your behind to church today. Sit right here. And you couldn't fight because you were so tired and so weak. And something happened. That's all God wants you to know is God is saying, he says, all I want you to do is just tell them. He says, because if they show up, he can show you. If you show up, he can show you. The reason why you don't have no hope because you won't show up. But if you show up, he'll show you that he's a healer. If you show up, he'll show you that he's a way maker. If you show up, he'll show you that he's a wheel in the middle of the wheel, Mike. If you'll show up, he'll show you that he'll fix financial situations. But you got to show up. He said, all things have been made ready. When I gave you Jesus, I gave you everything concerning like that. He said, but you won't show up, so he can't show you. Do you know what you're not showing up is causing you to miss out on? Anything you need. God said, if you show up, I'll show you that I'll fix your marriage. He said, if you show up, he'll show you that he can heal cancer. If he show up, he'll show you he can take the taste of crack out of your mouth, but you got to show up. If he show up, he can deal with a hard place in your heart where you can't forgive nobody, but you got to show up. He said, the table is ready, but you got to show up. You keep complaining about what you don't have, but you won't show up. So he can show you. Let's pray. Father, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you, God, because you have made all things ready. We thank you, God, because you are sending out those that you can trust that won't allow other people's excuses to render them useless, but will continue to go out and bring those that can't come bring themselves. Father, we thank you for a church in this season, God, that has become an ecosystem of social change where we are like-minded, where our concerns are your concerns, our ideas are your ideas. And God, we, our resources, God, are targeted for those, God, that need the resources, God. God, we thank you, God, that you are changing the mindset, God, of not just Christian Tabernacle, God, but the church as a whole, God, that the church has realized that church as usual is not working. It's not what you've called us to do. It's time for the church to get back into right alignment and to be in according to what you have called us to do, God. And God, whatever it takes, God, we're going to get those that need you. We're not going to sit back in here and shout around the church and step over with broke. running around the church and step over the hungry. Father, whatever it is, God, that you need us to do, God, trust us, we can do it. We will do it, God. We're selfless, God. And I know you're not going to call us to do anything, God, that you have not provided the provisions and equipped us for. So, God, send the resources. Send the people, God. Send whoever you need to send, God, so that the vision can be accomplished, God. God, we got faith for the new this year, God. We believe in God because you're doing a new thing. So, Father, we thank you. We pray for those that have come in here this morning and they're sick. Some of us had to be brought in here this morning, God. God, we ask, God, because they were loud, because they showed up, God, can you show them, God, that you're a healer? Because they pressed their way here this morning, God, can you show them that you're a deliverer, God? God, because they pushed their way through circumstances, through anxieties and through possible depression, God, but they show up, God, show me your mind regulator, your heart fixer. Father, we thank you. As we close out this year, we close out, God, gaining momentum going into 2019, God, that no one that wants you will not get you. No one who has a desire to do better will be stepped over. No one who wants to come out will not come out. Whatever it be, God, whatever you need us to do, wherever you need to go, send us, Lord. Send us, God, and we'll go. Because you know, we know that you have equipped us. So, Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Amen. God bless you. We're going to make way real quickly for our communion. We'll have you out here in the next few minutes. How many of y'all want to be effective in evangelism? As our deacons come, our ministers come, our elders come, our leaders come, we're going to... move expeditiously. Somebody asked me, Pastor, why you buy that handicapped bus? That's why. We don't want to be excused that we can't put a wheelchair on the bus, so we won't make sure we have it. Now, we don't expect you to stay in the wheelchair. We want you to show up so he can show you. Amen. Amen. Father, we thank you for this opportunity, God, to remember you, God, through the Holy Eucharist, God. God, as we partake in this communion, God, we pray, God, that it is not done haphazardly, but is done consciously and intentionally, God. God, that as we break the bread and eat the bread, God, that our bodies are being nourished, God, and spiritually and physically. That as we drink the juice of the blood, God, that, God, the blood is running warm through our veins, God, that whatever it is, God, that is out of line is coming into alignment. So, Father, we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. I love First Technician lead you out from the rear. Amen. For
is my strength from day to day. It will never lose its power, for it reaches to the high.
While they were at the table, the scripture says, that Jesus took the bread, he blessed the bread, he broke the bread, and he gave it to his disciples. Let us eat together. This is my blood of the New Testament covenant. This is the same blood that was shed for you. This is the blood that, when I was crucified, it went down and rent the veil from the top to the bottom in the temple. It is that same blood that is working on your behalf.